Welcome back everyone to the lecture about applied biomesh analysis. This week will be about feature extraction, and afterwards I will give you an introduction to ImageJ macro. And by the end of the day, you will be able to analyze this kind of data set I got from Anne Esslinger from Alberti Lab here in Dresden. And you see here that there are some yeast cells swimming around and they are changing their shape over time, and we want to measure shape over time. So therefore, automation is kind of necessary. Good, but let's start with feature extraction. So what does feature extraction mean? Feature extraction is a late processing step, often the last one, but not necessarily, for getting numbers out of images. So this is actually the step where you actually make numbers out of images. So for example, you can take an image, like in this case, and measure the mean intensity or the standard deviation or whatever. But you can also see it as a step at the very end of a long processing workflow. And if you think about, I mean, when you read these terms here, most of them should tell you something already. And you should, when you think of coming from an image to a measurement, you should always have these terms here in mind. And also the order is basically fixed. So, I mean, it makes no sense to do background subtraction after labeling, obviously, right? And from my point of view, also denoising is one of the very first steps you should actually do before background subtraction. Yeah, what's also important, sometimes people forget that acquisition is part of our image processing workflow. So if you realize in your feature extraction step that you cannot really get the measurement out you wanted to get out of your images, that means that either you did something wrong during labeling, or you did something wrong during segmentation, or you did something wrong in the filtering steps at the very beginning, or you were using the wrong microscope. So that would be unfortunate, I agree. But that's the way how life goes with image analysis, right? So we realize in one of these steps that we maybe cannot do what we wanted to do, and then we have to go back. And in the very worst case, it might mean that we switch to a different microscope, or that we do the sample preparation in a different way. And then all the steps work better, and then we can actually extract the feature we wanted to extract to. I'm just saying, this is life. This is not a problem. It's not bad. It's not wrong. We learn something on that way always, and we are repeating this way again and again and again. And at some point, we will have the scientific measurement we wanted to have. Good. What is a feature? A feature is a countable or a measurable property of an image or of an object in an image or of a region in an image, something like that, right? And sometimes also people or use the term feature extraction in a context where you say the method of finding a set of features which describes the physical property I would like to investigate is also feature extraction. So some people refer to the one or to the other thing, but at the end we are talking about making numbers out of images, right? So you can measure a lot of things, like intensity-based measures, like obvious, and we already did that earlier. So you can measure the mean intensity, you can measure the standard deviation of objects or of a whole image, so that's kind of something super simple to do. You can also measure shape. This is what we will do today in the exercise after this little lecture. So for example, you can measure how round an object is, right? So that might be necessary if you want to differentiate these cells under different conditions. And there are mixed features, for example, center of mass. I will show you soon what that means. Spatiotemporal features. So when you think about cell tracking, if you want to investigate how cells are moving in space over time, that involves space and time. That's why it's a kind of a mixed feature. And there, from data like that, you can measure first of all displacement, which is a distance, right? From that, you can over time get speed and acceleration by looking at different time points, how the displacement is and how the time between the time points, how the frame delay is. And furthermore, you can also measure things like overlap, co-localization, network analysis, and there's really like many, many things you could do. Unfortunately, we don't have so much time in this lecture that we can go through all of them. So I would, for now, keep it with the simple measurements. So intensity-based features, you saw them already when we were talking about histograms, because below the histogram In image J, you find already quite a selection of intensity-based features, and we will also talk a bit more in detail about them by the end of the semester when we talk about descriptive statistics. But for now, the mean intensity is something everybody can imagine what it means: minimum and maximum intensity, standard deviation. It's like terms from common language, and we will stick to them for some time. What's important to know is that these measurements, when you take them from an image or from an object in an image, they don't take any spatial relationship between pixels into account. It's just like looking at numbers, at a collection of numbers, doing some descriptive statistics on this list of numbers. Furthermore, there are these mixed features, like the center of mass, for example, and you can read the equations here. I'm not so much the equation person. I like to explain it more with images. I'm an image analyst. If you want to know the center of mass of an image, for example, you take all the pixel intensities in your image. So I have here a 5x5 pixel sized image, and you multiply the coordinate, which is here on top, with the intensity, and you do that for all pixels, and you sum that up. And you divide it by the total intensity in the image, so by all the numbers which are in the image here. When you look at it, when you think about it from a mathematical point of view, all the pixels with a zero, then the coordinates are not taken into account because we multiply with zero. So the center of mass must be somewhere here where there are actually intensities. And so the center of mass, I would suspect, is somewhere here. That's the center of mass of an image. This slide looks almost the same. The headline changed. The center of geometry, or the centroid, is actually exactly the same thing like the center of mass, but it's only defined for binary images. So that's the difference here. So if we take, for example, a thresholded image compared to the one before, we only have pixel intensities of 0 and 1 in our image, and we apply the same mass to it. That means that the intensity itself, like it was in the image before, where we had some twos and or different numbers in the image, are not taken into account. It's just yes, no. It's just multiply by one or not. And that's why the center of mass is not necessarily in the same position as the center of geometry, so, or the centroid. They are sometimes in slightly different positions. And depending on what you want to do, you have to take the one or the other into account. So again, as all the zeros are not taken into account, I would expect that the centroid is somewhere down there. And you also see here again that I wrote down the complicated math to show how this is actually calculated. When you think about the so-called bounding box is something quite often used to describe the position of objects, and not just the position, also the size of the object. So the bounding box is actually, in a two-dimensional case, it's four numbers. So it's where the object starts on the left and how wide it is, or sometimes also until where it goes, and the same in y direction. So we have position information in x and y, and we have width and height in x and y. And here you see example values for that. Perimeter. It's also kind of trivial. We just, in such a case, we have a binary image and we want to know the perimeter of the outline around the white object, around the pixels with value 1. We can just count the edges here in this particular case. And if the pixel size is not like one pixel, if it's some physical unit like microns, then we would have to multiply with the pixel size, of course, in order to get a physical correct measurement of the perimeter. So you can, on the one side, do it like that, just counting the edges and knowing the perimeter. And depending on with which software you work, you may the software may count a little bit differently. So, for example, it can take off round edges or fill little holes to make a smoother measurement. If you remember the first lecture, these edges in our images between black and white, or between different gray values, are not existent actually in the biological object. That's why it might make sense to smooth outlines in such a way and to calculate the perimeter, which is then maybe not more related to the actual perimeter in the biological sample. When I talk about perimeter, I usually take the simple one. So just in case at some point somebody asks you to measure the perimeter in a binary image of such a kind, go the easy way. And then there is Fered's diameter, and it describes the maximum distance between any two points of an outline. So that's the definition of it, right? So that's kind of a descriptor of extension of an object. And the minimum caliper, or sometimes called the minimum Fered, describes the shortest distance of a caliper where the object would still fit through. And the important thing to keep in mind here is that they don't have to be perpendicular to each other. So they can be in different directions, right? There is in ImageJ, but also in other softwares, there is a quite popular technique to measure the shape of objects. So we are now talking about shape descriptors, right? It's fitting an ellipse. So for every binary object we have in our image, we fit an ellipse to it, which describes it in a kind of optimal way. So for example, from such an image, we would fit an ellipse to get this one out, and then we describe the ellipse by their major and by their minor axis. So that's kind of the extension in the two directions. And these are perpendicular to each other, because that's the definition of an ellipse, right? There's another measure called the aspect ratio, and the aspect ratio describes the relative elongation of an object. So when you think about a circle, the aspect ratio of a circle is 1. So the aspect, right, it's as wide as it's long. So we divide the major axis by the minor axis, which are both of the same size in case of a circle. And if the circle becomes elongated, the aspect ratio increases. So like as you can see here, it doesn't take the direction into account. So if it's becoming wider like this, and I mean obviously some kind of smaller here, the aspect ratio still increases because we are describing the shape independent from the direction. And there are some more measurements, like diameter, circumference, area, stuff like that. I mean this is already or still standard geometry, and everybody takes it like that. That's what we learned in school at some point. And there are some more measurements like roundness and circularity where I am not entirely sure that they are standardized worldwide between all theoreticians and softwares where these kind of measures are used. I'm referring here to the implementation in ImageJ. So in ImageJ it is implemented like that. If you have a circle, obviously it's round and it's circular. That's why roundness and circularity of a perfect circle, if you had a perfect circle, right, is 1. That's the definition of it. As long as the object is still kind of round, and values should still stay close by 1. As soon as the shape is really changing a lot, roundness and circularity should go down towards 0. So for example, a triangle is not circular, not round. And the actual math behind you find here. So you can calculate these measures by yourself. And last year, a student asked in the course, what's the difference between circularity and roundness? It's much easier to explain the difference by doing it, right? So let's create a new image. That's a 100 times 100 pixels large black image. I will zoom in and I will draw a circle. And we will now measure shape descriptors of this particular circle. So by setting measurements in ImageJ and just ticking shape descriptors here and nothing else, we can measure circularity and roundness. So I'm now pressing the M button for doing a measurement. And you see here circularity is 0.997 and roundness is 0.9. And I will now use the brush tool to modify this circle, and then we will see how circularity and roundness are changing. Yeah, so you see that roundness didn't change so much, while circularity dramatically changed. And when you go back one slide, you will realize that roundness takes the area and the major axis into account, while circularity takes the area and the perimeter into account. And I fitted ellipse to that thing. The major axis may still be approximately be the same like before, but the perimeter was changing a lot when I was modifying this object. And that's why, again, depending on what you want to measure, you may either use roundness or circularity. If you want to learn differences of these things, try it out. That's the way to go. Okay, so let's assume we have a contour like that, and we would now like to derive the convex hull from this outline, from this contour. Let's imagine Pac-Man is living inside this contour, and Pac-Man likes eating corners. So like in this particular case, he found a corner which is really tasty, and he eats it, and then it's gone. And then he finds another corner he would like to eat, and he's eating it, and then it's gone. He can still eat this one, but then he cannot access a corner from the inside anymore, so he will starve. Unfortunately, now he's gone, and he brings us to the convex hull. So this is the convex hull. The right side shows the convex hull of the outline of the left side. And if we want to measure solidity of an object, we divide the area of the object by the area of the convex hull. So the area of the convex hull is usually larger or equal to the area of the object itself. So that means solidity is also between 0 and 1. Okay, that's for now. That's shape descriptors. We later want to use shape descriptors in this particular data set, but we don't want to do it all by clicking again and again and again for every frame of this video. And that's why I'm going to teach you ImageJ macro next, so that we can do the measurements of the shapes in this video for every time point, for every frame, automatically. See you soon!